Hey, it's Fran in the lab. It's a little early, hang on. Gotta have my tea. Well, this is unexpected. I usually don't do follow-up videos, but I've been called back into the lab on my day off because there have just been so many comments about this ridiculous video I made about this electromechanical frequency meter. So many people, so many comments, so many things that people are suggesting, and so many people upset that I didn't set up a lab thing on my bench to make a variable frequency driver to show the tines moving in different things. And I explained in the video I didn't do that because, you know, the setup was just going to be too complicated to do it safely without blowing something up. And people were like, oh, just, Fran, just take a power transformer, you flip it around, you drive the secondary, you plug it in the thing, boom, you put that fire, it's done. See, it's done. Done. Da-da-da, it's done. Okay. Oh, okay, so I'll explain why that doesn't work. But someone actually suggested something really cool that I didn't actually even think of. And of course, the first bit that I have to point out is that the coil in the meter is 16 kiloohms. That's 16,000 ohms. Very high impedance. So it's one of the primary reasons that driving it with a power transformer doesn't really work, but I'll get into that in a second. But because it is high impedance, it's actually perfect to be a pickup. And so someone said, hey, Fran, if you plug that in and played the tines, would you be able to hear it in an amp? And I thought, well, probably, yeah. So first thing I'm going to do is I set this up to be actually a pickup, running it into my 68 Silverface Fender Bassman. Gorgeous 68 Silverface and about 85 watts. Got the microphone down there. It's down near the speaker now. So get that, and I'm going to start with everything down. I got it on deep bass setting, and the heat's running, but it's so cold outside I'm not going to shut it off, so you might hear the heat running in the background, but okay. Yeah, definitely. Okay, I'm going all the way here. Too responsive, but that's sort of. The 60 hertz interference is picking up, but all this isn't grounded, is overwhelming. You can definitely hear the difference in the tone from the high to the medium. So that definitely works. Very inefficient, but If the coil were further forward, it's like the coil's right at the base of the tine. So if it were further forward, we get more, disturbance in the magnetic field. If the tines were moving, if their maximum point of movement was closer to the core of the magnetic field. But it does work. Okay, I'm going to turn down the amp here and put the amp on standby. Okay, so that's mystery number one. That actually was very cool. Okay, so there we go. Okay, the other thing people commented on this is, she said, Fran, isn't it radioactive? Those look like radium. That looks like a radium dial. Well, the paint is, it's got a dull, flat paint, and it's sort of off-white. But that in itself doesn't indicate a phosphorescent paint or a radium paint. In fact, actually, it wouldn't make sense for a meter like this to be radium because, radium dials have the radium on not only the dial, but also the actuator, the hands, or whatever. So if these were dipped in radium in a totally dark room, it wouldn't do you any good because you wouldn't know what the hell the meter is unless the dial itself were radiant. And clearly this is just enamel. They are, you know, dipped paint. It's lead paint, good old safe lead paint. And I did hit this with the Geiger counter, and I have my Geiger counter here, which I'm not even going to fire it up because it's not radioactive. But even if you don't have a Geiger counter, you can get an idea if a display is an illuminated dial, because even though, like with radium dials, even though the phosphors won't be stimulated by the alpha emissions anymore, they still can be stimulated by emissions in a different wavelength, like ultraviolet or even like strong full spectrum lighting. So you know, if you got just like a really good bright white flashlight, this is a Weston military spec radium milliammeter, and I showed these in a video before. These are very heavy. It's very heavy steel backing. It even says on the back that it's sealed, do not open. It's hermetically sealed, and it's got a very heavy, thick lead glass crystal on the front. I've hit this with the Geiger counter, and it really doesn't have very much signature above background at all. The face is completely ray shielded, and even though these numbers don't glow anymore, so if I charge up the phosphors, they will glow for an instant. Very, very brief. See it there? Okay. But that's one way you can test. If you've got an ultraviolet flashlight, you can test clock faces and find out if they have a luminous dial. Doesn't mean that it's radium, but if you have a luminous dial that falls into the radium years, you know, historically, then chances are good it's a radioactive meter. So if we do the same thing with this and charge that up, nothing. There's no phosphors. It is not a luminous dial. Okay. Here's another thing that I only saw after editing that was pointed out by a viewer, and this back end here, looking at the back end, that is where the tuning comes in. Behind each one of these tines is a blob of solder, and it is the blob of solder that changes the weight of each specific tine, so that all the tines are basically the same length and the same thickness of steel, but by changing the weight at the end, they can be calibrated to oscillate at a very specific frequency. Isn't that cool? My camera won't go close enough, but looking at it with my loop, I can see that the solder has been filed away. It's been just shaved away with a file. So each one of those tines has been individually tuned just by putting a blob of solder on each one that's big enough and then filing away until it reaches a very specific mass, and boom, it's tuned. Yep. So I guess technically these could be retuned by adding solder or removing solder as you see fit. But that's another cool thing. Okay, so another thing that was commented on a lot and mentioned many times, especially early on, was something to the effect of, Fran, I thought you were smart. You know, you don't know how this thing works. I know how this thing works. I mean, it's obvious. Isn't it obvious how this thing works? I mean, no, I mean, I said in the video that I racked my brain figuring out how this thing could work, having never even seen it. So, you know, when I bought the item, it was from a photograph. I didn't ever watch one of these operate. I didn't know what the action would be. I just saw a picture of the faceplate and thought, well, how could that work? It's like expecting that the action would be obvious would be like handing someone who's never seen a clock in their life, handing them a pocket watch and saying, isn't it obvious how this works? It's so stupid. Of course it works. I know how it works. Of course you know how it works because you've used a pocket watch and you've been told what runs a pocket watch. And so people are like, well, why don't you just Google it? Well, no, that's not how I learn. You know, I wanna explore the possibilities first. So it wasn't that I was mad that I didn't understand instantaneously how something like this would function. I went through the permutations of how could you do this. I mean, originally, when I saw this, I wasn't sure how it would look when it was on. I didn't know if it would be like some kind of a sinusoidal display, like throughout the whole thing, or if there were like actuators in there that were pulling levers up and down that you would have like a waveform showing on it, or if the actuator was like pulled up or down like by like a lever, to show it. I didn't know how the action was. It wasn't until I opened it up that it became obvious. So those of you who were smart enough to just see a picture of one of these things and right off the bat knew how it worked, well, congratulations to you. All right, so the other big question is a lot of people have been asking me, Fran, what are these plates for? Well, these plates are steel and they're hooked up to this insulator for the coil. So, I mean, I would speculate, obviously, these plates are there specifically to direct the magnetic field, because this coil is creating a magnetic field with a certain, level of influence. You would have these kind of dual oval fields, with a north and a south pole coming out of this that would go the length of the coil. So you'd have these fields like this, and these plates are running, would be running right through the center of those fields. And so these plates would be there to contour or direct the shape of that magnetic field. So they're closer together on the high side and further apart on the low side. So exactly why they're there probably has something to do with the inefficiency of the type of display that they, they had to put these plates in there and alter their width of the gap to compensate for other factors in the oscillation of these tines, But you can speculate about why, but it's certainly to shape the magnetic field. That would be my best guess. All right. Okay, so getting back to the most popular thread of discussion on the video was about, Fran, why not take a power transformer and flip it around, put an amp into the secondary, and then take the primary out, you drive that, boom, it's done. Okay, so there are two ends to that problem. Number one is, when I made that brief statement that I didn't do a setup like that because I had no interest in blowing anything up on my bench, primarily, if I were going to drive this, I'd be driving it with the biggest amplifier that I have in the lab, which is my 68 Silverface Bassman, which I have no intention of blowing up, but that Bassman has an output transformer that is designed to feed into a cabinet that's between 4 to 8 ohms. If I use that output to drive a power transformer like this, the secondary, this is a 24 volts, so it's 2420 volts secondary primary. And so if you hooked up the secondary end of this to this amplifier output, the winding on the secondary end is it's a fraction of an ohm. Let's see, 0.6 ohms. So 0.6 ohms. That Bassman would be cooking instantaneously. I would just be heating up that output transformer. It would be cooking and dying almost instantly. And that's only one half of the problem. The other problem is the primary side of this is 11.5 ohms. Okay, so you got 11.5 ohms output here feeding this 16,000 ohm load. So the impedance mismatch between a power transformer and this display is extreme. So 16,000 divided by 11.5, 1,390 some odd to one impedance mismatch. So I don't even have to do the math on that to know that an impedance mismatch of some 1,300 to one, where you have to try to get a watt, this takes its 7.5 milliamps at 120 volts, just under a watt. Maybe you want to deliver a watt of power into a 16k ohm load with a 10 ohm coil. How much power do you have to put into that transformer to get that kind of delivery? I'll let you do the math, but I'm not even going to set it up. So that's not a good idea. And some people are like, Fran, you just a MOSFET and an oscillator, you're done. MOSFET and an oscillator hooked up to what? You know, you need to get like RMS, you need like a 200 volt, like I'd have to use big iron, my 200 volt DC power supply and then have a MOSFET on that. And then, you know, you're trying to coax a watt out of it at 200 volts, you know. Like I said, I wasn't interested in making something catch fire. All those ideas are things I'm not going to do, but I realized after all these comments that, you know, I actually did have the perfect thing in my lab to actually try this out. This is a 12 watt audio isolation transformer. It goes from 600 ohms to 8 ohms. It's absolutely perfect for this. Because the secondary side, the 8 ohm side, is perfectly incompatible with my basement amp. Basement isn't going to see anything different than an 8 ohm cabinet, and it's not going to heat up. And at 12 watt capacity, this has plenty of kick to be able to deliver a watt through the 600 ohm end, because with the 600 ohm output, the incompatibility, instead of like 1300 to 1, be 26.6 to 1. So trying to deliver a watt through that, it's probably not going to melt anything, and even at a fraction of the output, we should be able to get a decent indicator on here using this isolation transformer. So that's what I'm going to do. All right, so I'm going to use my function generator. I got it on sinusoidal wave. It's got to be a sinusoidal wave. Can't really be a square wave because, again, a 50% duty cycle square wave would not get a single tine reading on this, I think, because of harmonic reasons. I have 0 dB. Test the output because I got it going right through the amplifier. So let's see. Just check the frequency response. Okay, I'm going to put the microphone down by the speaker. Now, first thing I'm going to do is test the dynamic range of the amp. So I'm going to see if we can get good response down. About to hook this up and looking at the transformer, I think the label's upside down. It's showing here that on the wire side it says 8 ohms, 4 ohms, 0 ohms, and on the tab side it says 0 ohms, 600 ohms. So it looks like that label's backwards. So this should be the 8 ohm side. Yep, that's the 8 ohm side. Okay, and this should be the 600 ohm side. 24, yeah, so right. So that's the output there, and that's the input. So always make sure with an ohmmeter before you go and hook it up. But it makes sense because the tabs would go to a speaker. Okay, all right, 70, and let's start turning up the power. Oh, yeah, see what I'm talking about? Oh yeah, okay, 70. Oh yeah, a little bit of harmonics there. Go to the upper end. Oh geez, did I say this was the perfect way or what? Okay, let's see if we get that last tine running on its own. Ooh, a little bit of frequency, a little crossover there. Now that's probably some harmonic noise. Let me turn down the preamp a little bit. Try to get as linear as I can. There's going to be some non-linearity here with because we got all these different transformers and loads and stuff, so it's probably not completely sinusoidal. There's probably some secondary oscillation and whatnot. Oof. Yeah. I'll turn down the power a little bit. Again, trying to get it as clean sine wave as I can. Ooh. Okay, that's 60, 50. 55. There we go. Yep. Transformer's cool. So there you go. 56. And this is Yep. 56. And turn up to 70. There we go. There you go. Mission accomplished. Done the right way. At Fran Lab. Woo! That's it for this one. Definitely. Thanks for watching. And thanks to everybody who commented on that original video. I mean, you inspired this video and got me back in the lab on my day off to answer all your questions and go through all the reasons and yada yada yada. And you motivated me to get this thing working and show you exactly what you demanded to see. You wanted to see it. Fran Lab delivers. Okay, there you go. Thanks to all the patrons out there who make all these videos possible, including this follow-up video. If you like this video, if you like anything that I do, consider becoming a patron, because it's really the reason I'm able to do these videos. Just follow the link in the description. Become a patron. Okay. I'm Fran. I'll be back here in the lab real soon with something else. Bye! Berserk in my lab. It's where I work. Watching Fran Lab. It's what I'm doing. Working at the bench again. Oh yeah, there was one more thing. Nuclear!